डॉक्टर बाबा साहेब आंबेडकर ओपन यूनिवर्सिटी।
हेलो एवरीवन, आई दर्शना दलवाड़ी, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर स्कूल ऑफ कंप्यूटर साइंस डॉक्टर बाबा साहेब आंबेडकर ओपन यूनिवर्सिटी इज़ वेलकमिंग यू टू द चैतन्य स्टूडियो ऑफ डॉक्टर बाबा साहेब आंबेडकर ओपन यूनिवर्सिटी इन द लेक्चर सीरीज ऑफ साइबर सिक्योरिटी एसेंशियल प्रिंसिप इन द लेक्चर सीरीज ऑफ प्रिंसिपल्स ऑफ साइबर सिक्योरिटी। इन लास्ट लेक्चर वी हैव सीन अबाउट द सिक्योरिटी कॉन्सेप्ट्स, देन द इंडियन साइबर स्पेस एंड द डेफिनेशन ऑफ साइबर सिक्योरिटी। टूडे इन दिस लेक्चर वी आर गोइंग टू सी द रिमेनिंग कॉन्सेप्ट्स ऑफ साइबर सिक्योरिटी। नाउ फर्स्ट बिफोर मूविंग ऑन दैट वी नीड टू रिवाइज वॉट एवर वी हैव डन इन लास्ट लेक्चर। वॉट एवर वी हैव डन इन लास्ट लेक्चर, इन प्रीवियस लेक्चर वी डिस्कस्ड मीनिंग ऑफ साइबर सिक्योरिटी, इट्स डेफिनेशन, देन इंडियन साइबर स्पेस, what Indian government has done, the steps taken by Indian government, the initiatives taken by Indian governments for cyberspace, then key initiatives launched by government of India, and security concepts, confidentiality, integrity and availability. Security concepts, confidentiality, integrity and availability, these things we have discussed in previous lecture. Now moving forward to remaining topics, we are going to see today security concepts and basic cryptography. Now we have seen in last lecture that three things are important in any information security system, that are confidentiality, integrity and availability. That was called as the CIA triad. Now with this CIA triad, some additional concepts are there which we need to understand and which are important to learn and understand the system. When we are talking about these three additional concepts, it is helping us to make the complete picture of our information security system. Now which are that three concepts? That three concepts are authentication, authorization and non-repudiation. Now when we are talking about this and when we are talking about this three concepts and the concepts we have seen in CIA triad, total six concepts we have which we need to understand for any security system. Now understanding each of the six concepts will help to implement the robust security mechanism. Now first one we have, that is authentication. Now what do we mean by authentication? For any security system, the primary goal is to focus on authenticity of information and source of the message. This means that the users are authorized and every piece of information comes from the trusted source. Nowadays, authentication system requires more than one factor of authentication. It is called as multi-factor authenticity or multi-factor authentication. In previous era, we were having authentication with the help of only username and password. But nowadays, for authentication, only username and password is not enough. We need to add something else with these two things. What are that? We can add fingerprints, retina scan, voice verification, PIN, personal identification number, useful in validating the owner of the fingerprints, and PIN number, which is something that the user is knowing. These are the additional things which we can combine with the password, with which we can have multi-factor authentication. Now, authorization. It focuses on whether the user is verifiably granted permission to do so or not. Whatever task the user is doing, for that the permission is granted to that user or not, that process is called as the authorization. When the system authenticates the user, it also verifies and checks access privileges granted to the users, which in simple terms means what a user can or cannot do while using the system. Now, third concept we are having, it is sixth one. Confidentiality, availability, integrity, then after we have seen authentication, authorization, and now we are having non-repudiation. It is assuring that the sender of the data is provided with the proof of delivery and recipient is provided with the sender's identity. Neither can deny in later part of having processed data. It can be understood as the notary, which is done on the stamp paper for any kind of deals. This is the simple example that we are having non-repudiation. Means no one party can deny from the stamp paper. When we are talking about the example of stamp paper for any kind of deal, at that time neither of the parties can deny the deal. At the later stage, whatever is written on that stamp, both the parties have to follow it. This is called as the non-repudiation. After this, we are having the next topic, that is basic cryptography. Now, up to this we have seen that what is cyber security, what are the measures taken by the government, and the concepts which we need to understand in cyber security. Now, after this we are having the use of cryptography in computer security. Now, this section will provide the information on basic cryptography to explain the basics of ciphers and crypt analysis. We will discuss the basic operation on symmetric and asymmetric encryption algorithms, the concept of the digital signatures. With the help of these things, we can make our system more secure. The word cryptography is derived from the Greek word and its literal translation is hidden writing. Cryptography means what? We are having simple information, but instead of storing this information as it is, we are converting it into some other form with the help of algorithms, and that new derived form is stored. That is called as the cryptography. In simple terms, we can understand cryptography as this. Then after, in old times, it mostly used to send the secret messages in a way that the intended recipient can only be able to read. To whomsoever it is concerned, only that person can understand, can read that message. In old time, they were sending the messages in that secret form. Cryptography is a very critical and important part of the security applications, the products, and applications in terms of using different cryptographic algorithms. In early around 1900 BC, Egyptians began to use pictographic to convey the secret message. This was known to be a cipher. This is the basic cipher. Cipher means, in simple terms, we can say converting something into some other form with the use of some symbols or some pictographs. Cryptography can be strong or weak. Its strength is measured in time and resources it would require to cover the plain text. We are saying that it can be strong or weak, but how we can decide? It can be measured in the form of time it requires and the resources it required to get the text back. If we require more time, if we require more resources, it means we are having strong cipher, strong cryptography. And if we are getting it easily, then it is called as the weak cryptography. Then after, a cryptographic algorithm is a mathematical function. Now next thing we have, that is, how does cryptography work? We are talking about this cryptography, the conversion from plain text to ciphertext, but to do so we need something. That is what? That are cryptographic algorithms. So that comes in picture when we want to have the cryptographic data. Now what is a cryptographic algorithm? A cryptographic algorithm is a mathematical function which is used in encryption and decryption process. Now cryptography is a science of securing the data. Crypt analysis is the science of analyzing and breaking secure communication without knowledge of the key. When we are talking about this cryptography, we are having the combination of cryptography plus crypt analysis. With the help of these two, we are having cryptology. You have the meaning of cryptography. It is the science of securing data. Crypt analysis is the science of analyzing and breaking secure communication without knowledge of the key. And when we are combining these two, we are getting cryptology. The most common classical cipher is the substitution cipher, which works by substituting each letter in the alphabet with one another when we are writing the secret message. The key here is the number of characters which is used for substitution. Now here we are talking about how classical cipher is working. Classical cipher means simple cipher in which we are having letters which are substituting each letter with another alphabet. Now how we are getting it, that we are going to see now. For example, we can say that I am having one substitution cipher of alphabets A to Z, where I am giving a new alphabet N, to B I am giving O, to C I am giving P. Likewise, I am assigning different alphabets to different basic alphabets up to Z. So to Z I am having the letter M. So this is what I have done for ciphering my message, for doing cryptography of my message. Using this cipher, the message "Hello World," using this cipher, the message "Hello World" would be written as URYY B, which stands for hello, and J B E Y Q, which stands for world, according to the example of substitution cipher which we have taken here. If I am having other substitution cipher, then my message would be different. It is a simple substitution cipher which is known as Caesar cipher. The cipher which we have applied here, the substitution cipher which we have applied here, is the simplest example of substitution cipher which is known as Caesar cipher. Now we are having two type of encryptions, symmetric encryption and asymmetric encryption. Symmetric encryption and asymmetric encryption. Now in symmetric encryption, we can say that it is also known as conventional encryption. Symmetric encryption is also known as conventional encryption. This was introduced in the late 1970s. This technique is used to provide confidentiality to data transmission. There are two well-known symmetric encryption algorithms. First one is Data Encryption Standard, DES, and Advanced Encryption Standard, AES. Both algorithms are block ciphers. The examples of block cipher encryptions. Both algorithms are block cipher encryption algorithms. Here you can see we are having one plain text input that is called as X here. Then we are applying some encryption algorithm with the secret key shared by sender and recipient. Key is K here. After applying encryption algorithm, we are getting some transmitted ciphertext. We are getting some ciphertext, that is Y. Y is equal to encrypted form of key along with the plain text input K. With the combination of these two, we are getting the new ciphertext which is transmitted at the receiving side. At receiving side, what happens? With the help of secret key which is shared by the sender to recipient, they are trying to apply the decryption algorithm. Whatever encryption we have applied, we just have to do the reverse of that encryption. What it will do in turn? In turn, it will decrypt the information. Means we are doing the reverse process. So now when we are applying the decryption algorithm, at that time we are receiving original plain text what the sender has sent to the recipient. This is called as the symmetric encryption model. Now in this we need to understand some terms whatever we have used here. First thing we have, that is plain text. Now what do you mean by plain text? Plain text is original message or data which is provided as input into the algorithm. In simple terms, we can say the input which we are providing in algorithm, that is called as the plain text. Then second thing we have, that is encryption algorithm. Now encryption algorithm is what? Which is used to perform operations on the plain text. On plain text, whatever operations we are performing, that algorithm is called as the encryption algorithm. Third thing we have, that is secret key. Secret key is also an input which is provided to the encryption algorithm. We are having encryption algorithm. To it, one key we are providing, which is also one type of input. With the help of that, we can get our encrypted form. the exact number of substitution or transformations performed by algorithm is dependent on the key. How many number of substitutions or transformations we will have in our algorithm all depends on the key which we are having. After applying these three things, we will get one ciphertext. That is the encrypted message which is produced as output. In simple terms, we can say the output after applying encryption algorithm is called as the ciphertext. It depends on the plain text and key which is used. For the same message, if there are different keys used, ciphertext will be different for both keys which are used. Suppose I am having one message. I am the sender. I am sending that message to two different users with two different secret keys. Then, for the first user, whatever key I have used, with it, the data will be encrypted. I will get encrypted form. At receiving side, the user will decrypt the data. At receiving side, the user will decrypt the data with the key provided. They will get the answer. To other user, I am sending same message with different key. Now what the other user will do? He or she will encrypt the message with the other key, as well as decryption is also done with the help of that other key. So at the end, at receiving side of user 1 and user 2, the messages which are decrypted will be different, because that two different users are using different keys to decrypt it. So the message decrypted will be different, as the keys used are different. Now up to this we have seen plain text, ciphertext, encryption algorithm. Now fourth term we have, that is decryption algorithm. Now decryption algorithm means what? Now decryption algorithm means what? It is the same encryption algorithm which runs in the reverse manner. Whatever encryption we have done, we just have to reverse it to get original message. That is called as the decryption. And the algorithm we are using is called as the encryption algorithm. And the algorithm we are using is called as the decryption algorithm. It takes the ciphertext and secret key as the input and generates the original plain text. To get it back, what we need to have? We need to have the ciphertext and the secret key. That will be the input. It will apply decryption algorithm and will get the original plain text. There are two requirements for the symmetric encryption algorithm. First one is strong encryption algorithm known to both the parties, sender and receiver, and the secret key should be known only to sender and receiver. If these two things are there in our system for message sending and receiving, then the proper symmetric encryption will be done. Symmetric cryptography doesn't address the issues like attacker can eavesdrop the shared key between sender and receiver and can steal the key and decrypt the data. Sometimes we may have some issue like this, like sender is sending the data, receiver is receiving the data, but before the receiver receives the data, attacker is stealing the information in between that transmission. They are having the key also, they are stealing the key also, and with the help of that key, they are decrypting the data. This is where the concept of public key encryption or asymmetric key cryptography comes in picture. Now, the limitation of symmetric encryption is this, that in between the transmission, if the attacker is stealing the information, stealing the key, then they can have the data. So to overcome this problem, what is the solution? Solution is, instead of having secret key, use public key encryption or asymmetric key cryptography. Now, here we have seen the concept of how cryptography works, its encryption types, symmetric encryption and asymmetric encryption. In today's lecture, up to symmetric encryption we have seen. Next point we will discuss in next lecture. Thank you.
Swadhyayah Parah.